Dobroveče, dobroveče, dobrodošli, ali čujte, okolnosti neznatne hitnje nalažu da, pa i možda bi bolje da, da pročitam svoj govor kako bi bio dovoljno, dovoljno vremenit i dinamičan, pa u tom smislu bih za početak da se obratim u ime Kulturnog centra Beograda i da uputim nekoliko protokolarnih, ali zapravo ponajpre srdačnih reči i da se zahvalim organizatorima, naravno u prvom redu izdavačka kuća Akademska knjiga, koja je do sad objavila, ima tome već 6 naslova autora Tome Piketija, zatim Francuskom institutu u Srbiji i Institutu za filozofiju i društvenu teoriju, na prilici i u pravom smislu te reči možda već i događaju koji publiku očekuje večeras u prostoru dvorane Kulturnog centra. Zahvaljujući ovoj saradnji i organizaciji i dobroj volji koja je na delu, u prilici smo da prisustvujemo predavanju Toma Piketija o, čini mi se, neotklonjivo važnoj temi, čiji naziv odgovara i nedavno objavljenom naslovu. Znači, prema tome uskoro će uslediti kratka istorija jednakosti uz odgovarajuće moderiranje koleginice Zore Zarica, Zore Zarica Instituta za filozofiju i društvenu teoriju. I nadam se da će ono u izvesnom smislu predstavljati moment sile koji će biti podsticajan i adekvatno usmeriti naše razmatranja različitih okolnosti upisanih u veliku temu ekonomske i posledično društvene nejednakosti i u svetlu našeg, da kažem, društvenog sapostojanja. Prema tvrdnji samog autora, u ostalom, sticanje saznanja o preobražavanju odnosa moći je obavezni minimum i takođe i neka vrsta obaveze koju imamo prema svojoj svakodnevici i koju imamo prema svojoj budućnosti. U ostalom, da, upravo zbog toga se tokom i nakon ove večeri Tom Piketty upisuje u redove, ja kažem, ne najistaknutih, sve prilika možda i najneophodnijih gostiju, govornika i predavača koje je dvorana Kulturnog centra u sada svojih već 60 godina kontinuiranog postojanja imala priliku da, da ugosti i čuje. Da, čujte, nema razloga da ne predam mikrofon Zoni. Izvolite i hvala i dobrodošli.
Hvala, Jelena. Hvala, Jelena. Hvala na sjajnoj organizaciji. I'm going to switch to English now. I want to invite you all to grab a seat because there are a few seats left. Make yourselves comfortable. Thank you for showing up in such large numbers. It's so wonderful to see. Thank you most of all to Julia Cagé and Thomas Piketty that took their time to be with us here in Belgrade, to spend a weekend here sharing their expertise and knowledge. This evening we will have this special opportunity to listen to a lecture by Thomas Piketty. But before I give him the floor, I would like to just introduce a little bit, give you a few words about Thomas Piketty, and before all of that, give the floor to our partners. And for this special few minutes, we want to set aside to give an award to Thomas Piketty. So I invite Gazela Pudar-Draško, the director of the Institute for Philosophy and Social Theory, Bora Babic, the director of Akademska knjiga, the publisher of Thomas Piketty and Julia Cagé, to come and join us and say a few words.
Dear colleagues, dear friends, dear guests, I'm deeply honored that I can wish a warm welcome to all of you tonight on this exceptional occasion, as we have the privilege of having Thomas Piketty among us. Thomas Piketty has become a prominent figure, actively participating in and shaping the debates of utmost societal importance in the global public sphere. He is firmly committed to enriching the public discourse with his profound insights and perspectives. In his public appearances, he passionately advocates for implementation of the universal basic income, endorsing the idea that operationalization of this measure is a step closer to a social system that uplifts and empowers every individual, ensuring their fundamental well-being and dignity. 3 years ago, he published the book Vimonli Socialism, in which Piketty advocates for a socialism 3.0, characterized as decentralized, participatory, and self-managed socialism, which strongly resonates with Yugoslav experience and lessons we actually may learn from its failure here. Since 2021, Professor Piketty has been a member of International Scientific Board at the Institute for Philosophy and Social Theory, as an institution that is committed to advancing critical thinking and social analysis. Accepting this membership, which he rarely does, and thank you very much for that, demonstrates his unwavering dedication to engage social sciences that affirms and protect the values of the international academic community. His presence on this board obliges us to push forward and give our best to make the values we share more visible and provide the answers that only social sciences and humanities can offer in this challenging context that surrounds us. That is to create a more equitable and just society. His contributions have not only enriched the academic discourse, but have also paved the way for deeper discussion on social economic issues that are of vital importance to the region and beyond. Now I have just a brief reflection on Miladin Životić, because this award we are going to present now is named after him. Miladin Životić was one of the founders of the Institute for Philosophy and Social Theory and one of the praxis philosophers. And I would say that when he died in 1997, he would think that society today is probably in Serbia and here in the region quite similar to the society he lived when he died. I would think also that he would claim that he failed in his attempts to do everything which I describe here as something which is our objective. But still, I deeply believe that today when we are standing here and when we are having our distinguished guest here with us, that we are doing our best to live his heritage and that he can be proud of us and that he didn't fail. So we are here to secure that what he envisaged didn't fail and will not fail. So taking all into consideration and with deep gratitude for his contribution to preserving the autonomy of the Institute once more, it's my honor and our honor to present Professor Toma Piketty as the recipient of Miladin Životić Annual Award for Critical Engagement for the year 2023. Thank you.
Poštovana publiko, dragi prijatelji, u ime izdavačke kuće Akademska knjiga želim da vas pozdravim i da se zahvalim Žili Kaže i Tomi Piketiju što su doputovali u Srbiju i što žele da svoje istraživačko iskustvo podele sa svojim čitaocima. Čekamo ih, Tomu čekamo 8 godina, ali došao je i taj dan i veoma sam srećna što vas vidim večeras sa publikom u Srbiji. Akademska knjiga je do sada objavila 6 knjiga, sve knjige ćete moći da vidite na izlazu iz dvorane. Biće prilike da Toma Piketty možda eventualno nekome i potpiše knjigu. Ukoliko ne stignete danas, pozivamo vas da sutra u 13.30 dođete na sajam knjiga, na štand Akademske knjige, gde će Toma potpisivati svoje knjige. Zašto objavljamo Tomu Pikettyja? Ja verujem u ideje Tome Pikettyja, verujem da njegove knjige daju viziju čovečanstvu i verujem da njegove knjige mogu učiniti svet boljim i perspektivnijim. Jedva čekamo da čujemo Tomu Pikettyja. Hvala vam što ste došli u ovolikom broju. Hvala Francuskom institutu što podržava objavljivanje knjiga Tome Piketija. Hvala našim partnerima, Institutu za filozofiju i društvenu teoriju, Kulturnom centru Beograda i hvala još jednom svima.
Okay, so not to keep you waiting for too long, I'm just going to let you know how the event is going to be organized. After I say a few words of a more general introduction into Thomas Piketty's life and work, he will give a lecture that will be followed by questions from Professor Jelena Žarković from the University of Economics, and then questions to the audience. So a brief introduction that I prepared to share with you and that I gladly and happily get to share with such a big and full room. Once again, squeeze in, there's a lot of people still outside. So Thomas Piketty is professor at EHSS and the Paris School of Economics. At the age of 18, he entered the École Normale Supérieure de la Rue d'Ulm, and at 22, he defended his doctoral thesis in economics, prepared at the EHSS and the London School of Economics. The thesis was entitled Essays on the Theory of Wealth Redistribution. This thesis was awarded the 1993 prize for best thesis by the Association Française de Sciences Économiques. After defending his thesis, he left to teach at MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, from 93 to 95. Then he returned to France to become a research fellow at the Centre National de la Recherche Scientifique and director of studies at the EHSS from 2000. In 2002, he was awarded the prize for Best Young French Economist. Subsequently, in 2005, he was entrusted by Dominique de Villepin, then Prime Minister of France, with the significant undertaking of establishing a French academic institution capable of rivaling the esteemed London School of Economics. Professor Piketty has dedicated himself to this ambitious project since 2004. The fruition of this effort resulted in the establishment of the École d'Économie de Paris, of which he became the first director at the end of 2006. In 2001, his book, High Revenues in France in the 20th Century, Inequality and Redistribution, 1901-1998, published by Grasset, provided a comprehensive analysis of long-term trends in high incomes in France, underscoring the crucial role of the tax system in addressing inequality. As the 2000s unfolded, Professor Piketty's research further illuminated the exasperation of inequality, particularly in the United States, which was attributed to the surge in exceedingly high incomes propelled by financialization. These observations echoed the theoretical and empirical analyses put forward by numerous heterodox economists and laid the foundation for the rallying cry, "We are the 99%, they are the 1%, that was synonymous of the Occupy Wall Street movement in 2011. Following in the footsteps of eminent US economists like Joseph Stiglitz and Paul Krugman, Professor Piketty progressively developed a more critical stance towards financial capitalism in the late 2000s. He underscores the nonlinear nature of progress in the context of inequality and rejects the notion that the existing social order is destined to endure indefinitely. Throughout history and across society, he contends that elites have employed narratives to legitimize disparities. This trend persists in hypercapitalism, which employs a meritocratic rhetoric that seeks to induce guilt among those who are disadvantaged by the system. In 2013, Professor Piketty's seminal work, Capital in the 21st Century, ignited a worldwide debate concerning the role of taxation in addressing inequalities that favor rentiers. In this work, he posits that over long periods, the rate of economic growth is lower than the return on capital, which tends to benefit the wealthiest individuals and reinforce their dominance. In 2019, Professor Piketty published Capital and Ideology, serving as an extension of his earlier work, offering a comprehensive historical account of inequalities, the concept of ownership, and the ideological frameworks that have historically justified them. In 2021, he further encapsulated his research in A Brief History of Equality, highlighting the persistent reduction of equality over the long term. Professor Piketty argues that only a comprehensive global tax reform can rectify the adverse trends caused by the financialization of economies. He proposes transformative solutions that do not seek to abolish private property, but rather seek to foster widespread distribution for collective benefit. These proposals include the implementation of an annual and progressive property tax, the establishment of a universal capital endowment providing 120,000 euros to all 25-year-olds with a particular focus on encouraging home ownership, and the promotion of cooperative management models that enable employees to actively engage in company affairs. These ideas align with the concept of participatory socialism. Professor Piketty has published numerous books that delve into both historical and theoretical analyses of the intricate relationships between economic development and wealth distribution. His research has garnered recognition through publication in esteemed international journals, including the Quarterly Journal of Economics, the Journal of Political Economy, the American Economic Review, and the Review of Economic Studies. As early as 2012, Professor Piketty's influential stature was acknowledged by the Anglo-Saxon magazine Foreign Policy, which included him in their list of 100 most influential intellectuals. In 2014, his book Capital in the 21st Century sparked a substantial global public debate, selling over 2.5 million copies worldwide. The book not only garnered critical acclaim, but also received prestigious accolades such as the Petrarch Prize and the British Academy Medal. In 2017, he joined Benoît Hamon's campaign team for the presidential election representing the Socialist Party. In this capacity, he passionately championed the cause of implementing a universal basic income, advocating for a society that uplifts and empowers every individual, ensuring their fundamental well-being and dignity. And since 2021, he has been a member of the International Scientific Board of our Institute of Philosophy and Social Theory. This appointment is a testament of his unwavering commitment to an engaged science that doesn't shy away from confrontation, but asserts and protects the values of an international academic community. And as stated earlier by Bora Babic, 6 of his books have already been translated into the Serbian language. You can buy them and have them signed at a special price at the fair and today, so at the fair tomorrow and today. Those books are Capital and Ideology, Measuring Racism, Overcoming Discrimination in partnership publication with the Institute of Philosophy and Social Theory, and A Brief History of Equality, Time for Socialism, How to Democratize Europe and Capital for the 21st Century. Thank you, Thomas, and I leave the floor to you.
Thank you all. So I'm very glad to be here tonight. I'm sorry that my English sounds a lot like French, and you know I hope you can still understand what I have to say. I'm very, very glad to be in Belgrade tonight. Sorry, Bora, that it took 8 years to come. Thanks for publishing all these books. You know, I cannot imagine, you know, all the work for translating such long books. This is, you know, coming to Belgrade today for me is very important. It's actually the second time I come to Belgrade, but the first time was I was a student in 1990. In the summer of 1990, I spent, you know, traveling in what was Yugoslavia, and I was 19 years old. Yes, well, that was 33 years ago, and I'm 52, and it was time to come back. So thanks for the invitation. I'm very glad to be here tonight. So I'm going to. So maybe I should stand, that will be easier to look at this. So I'm going to tell you about this book, this Brief History of Equality, which is the latest book I published. Well, before the book we just published in French with Julia Cage on the history of elections in France, but that will be for another talk. So this is the book. So this was published in French in 2021. This was published in English in 2022, and this just came out, I guess, in Serbia. So this is a much shorter book than my previous books, I should say. So, and I think it's also a better book in the sense that, you know, it's clearer about the main message, and it has you know, this optimistic dimension, stressing the existence of a long-run movement toward more equality, a long-run movement that comes from enormous political mobilization and social struggle. So this is a movement that certainly does not come, you know, in a spontaneous manner. This is full of social fight, political mobilization. But in the end, this is a very powerful movement. And, you know, the central message of the book is, of course, that this story is not over and could and should continue in the future. And looking at this past record and at this past movement toward equality, I think is one of the best way we have to prepare ourselves for the next step. So this is going to be the central message of the book, and I'm going to try to summarize some of the main arguments today. I will also present some material from this World Inequality Report, which is a report that we publish in Paris at the World Inequality Lab. Gosh, I am losing the plugs, which is not good because you know, if it doesn't work anymore. Okay. And so you can get the report online very easily, and I'm going to present some of the results from this report. More generally, this report and a lot of this historical data on inequality that I present in my work, that I analyze in my work, and that we present in this report comes from this World Inequality Database, WID.world, that you can all look at online. I should say that this is really a very collective participatory project. So, you know, I am the only one responsible for the historical interpretation that I develop in my book, but I am certainly not the only one responsible for the empirical work and, you know, historical work in archives that made all these books possible. So in particular, in this, the World Inequality Database involves the work of more than 150 researchers from all around the world, lots of young researchers, old researchers, well, lots of young students, master students, PhD students, postdoctoral researchers who have contributed to this from all over the world. And this is very much an ongoing process. And one of the tasks is not only to feed social science research on inequality and the evolution of our societies, but also can be used as a citizen tool in order to put pressure on government about, you know, what's going on in the various countries in terms of distribution of wealth, distribution of income, gender inequality, environmental inequality, which are now part of the database. So what I'm going to do in this presentation is I'm going to start by showing you a number of results from the World Inequality Report about the structure of inequality today. And then I will go back through history, showing you some of the conclusions from my brief history of equality in order to better understand how we got there. So let me start with a first map of the world. So I hope you can see more or less the color. But so here we have a simple indicator of inequality, which is the share of total income going to the top 10% of the population. So just to, I mean, I don't want to bore you too much with the numbers, the details of the numbers, but the orders of magnitude, I think, are important. So we're talking about the top 10% of the population. So by definition, if we had complete equality, they should have 10% of total income because they are 10% of the population. And if we had complete inequality, they should have 100% of total income and nothing left for the rest. Now, the real world, by definition, is always between 10 and 100. But the first result I want to stress is that it can go basically from 20, 21 to 67. So you can have as little as 25% of total income for the top 10, that will be in Nordic Europe. Well, more generally in European countries, it will be between 20-35%. I should say Serbia is a country where it has increased according to our database in the past 20 years, more than in a number of neighboring European countries. But by and large, if we look, we are not going to talk about each country separately today. So if we look at big regions in the world, by and large, Europe has a more, relatively more equal distribution of income, with 20 to 35% of total income going to the top 10%, whereas the most unequal country in the world here will be South Africa, where you will have 67% of total income going to the top 10. Then you have a number of countries in the southern part of Africa, which are also very unequal. So here, the historical legacy of inequality is pretty clear, with the apartheid and very strong racial inequality in land ownership and, you know, and pretty much everything. The other part of the world where you have a quite extreme inequality would be Latin America, with in particular Brazil, Chile, Mexico, where you would have 60%, 55, 60, sometimes up to 65% for the top 10%. Now, so that's the first conclusion, is that you have enormous variation across country. Now, the second conclusion is that these differences across countries, as we are going to see, are not frozen over time. They change over time. So in particular, Europe looks relatively equal today. Well, we are going to see in a minute that Europe is also very unequal, but as compared to South Africa, Brazil, you know, it looks relatively equal today. Now, it's not always been like that. So if we go back in time 100 years ago, the top 10% share in Europe it will not be quite South Africa, but it will be more like Latin America today. So between 50 and 60% of total income to the top 10. So it has reduced enormously over time, and this didn't come as a simple linear process. It involved it's in the wave of World War I, World War II, trade union movement, the development of social security, the existence of a communist counter model in the East, which completely changed or contributed to change the balance of power between capital and labor in the West. So it has been the outcome of a very conflictual process and a process of institutional transformation through the building of social security, public services, progressive taxation. So it's not always been like that, and it has changed through specific historical processes, which other parts of the world may not have gone through the same processes. So that's quite striking when we look at this top 10% income share. It's also very striking if you look, maybe it's even more interesting to look, this is the bottom 50% income share. The order of magnitude, you are 50% of the population. If you have complete equality, you should have 50% of total income. If you had complete inequality, you should have 0%. So in practice, it's always between 0 and 50. In practice, it's going to go from 5 to 30. So 5% is going to be again South Africa, and 20, 25, 30 is going to be Nordic Europe. Look how much difference it makes. You know, it means that for the same average income in a given country, so for the same total GDP or total national income and average income per individual in a given country, the average income of the bottom 50% of the population, whether it is 5% of total income or 25% of total income, it means that the average income of the bottom 50% can vary from a factor of 1 to 5. So, you know, if you're interested in poverty and in access to basic fundamental goods like housing, food, and clothes, and you know, just the situation of economic deprivation and absolute poverty, if you only look at total GDP of a country, you're going to miss an enormous part, because for the same global GDP, again, the average income of the bottom 50%, so a huge part of the population, can vary from a factor of 1 to 5. It would be even more extreme if we look at the bottom 10, bottom 20%, which I should say, here I'm only simplifying the picture by looking at big groups, but if you look in my work, or if you look in the World Inequality Database, you will find all the information percentile by percentile, and you can make much finer distinction. There will be a lot to say on this map country by country, you know, Latin America in general is very unequal, but Argentina, for instance, which had through the building of a sort of Peronist welfare state, not quite the same welfare state as in Europe, but you can see that the share of income going to the bottom 50% is a lot higher than in Brazil or Chile or Mexico. So, you know, there are lots of political story in each region of the world which deserve careful scrutiny, which, you know, we are not going to do that here, but, you know, there will be a lot more to say about the different parts of the world. So at this stage, you know, what we've seen is income inequality. There's a lot of variation across countries of the world, and political decisions, different political systems matter, in particular in the way Europe became relatively more equal in the course of the 20th century, and we will come back in a minute on this evolution. Now, the second part of inequality I want to mention, you know, the World Inequality Database initially started with a focus on income inequality, and in the recent years, and in particular in the World Inequality Report 2022, there are three main innovations. One is to introduce inequality of wealth. The other one is gender inequality, and the last one are environmental inequalities. So let me start with wealth. Now, so income is what you earn during a given year. So it can be labor income, capital income in terms of dividend, profits, rent. So that's what you earn during a given year. Wealth is what you own at any given point in time. So this includes housing, real estate, but also company ownership, financial portfolio, equity, bonds, net of debt. So it's always net wealth that we are looking here. So what you see, basically, so this is a graph from the World Inequality Report 2022, is that the inequality in wealth is always pretty large. It's always much bigger than inequality of income. So you can see, again, Europe looks a bit more equal than other parts of the world, but, you know, this should not be exaggerated. You know, I think sometimes there's a tendency in Europe to tell the citizen of Europe, look, you are so lucky to be in such an equal continent. You know, you're not in Brazil, you're not in South Africa. But, you know, I think citizens of Europe know that they are not in Brazil and South Africa, and that's not the right comparison. You know, the comparison is maybe Europe 20, 30 years ago, or some kind of alternative economic system which we have partly built in the past and which could continue to be built in the future. So rather than comparing to, you know, worse situation, we can look at better situation. And in terms of concentration of wealth, I think it's important to insist that, okay, in Europe, you know, the bottom 50% has about 4% of total wealth. So, you know, this is better than Latin America, where it's only 1% of total wealth for the bottom 50%, but, you know, this is not a lot, 4% for 50% of the population. So, you know, we should not exaggerate the magnitude of the movement toward more equality. Yes, there's been a movement toward more equality, in particular in income, but it's still limited, and in terms of wealth distribution, it is very limited. So, you know, the real difference, if you look at Europe as compared to other parts of the world, and also, as we will see later, when we compare Europe today with Europe 100 years ago, is that today you have this sort of middle 40% group, which is not really in the middle. It's people who are in between the bottom 50% and the top 10%, so they're actually above the median. But it's interesting to look at them separately, because this is really the group whose wealth share has increased over time. So if you go back, we will see that in a minute, 100 years ago, the top 10% share in Europe, say before World War I, was 80 to 90% of total wealth, and the middle 40%, you know, this sort of patrimonial middle class, was almost as poor as the bottom 50%. You know, they had like maybe 10% of total wealth, so they were a bit richer than the bottom 50% by definition, but they were not very much richer. So they, in a way, there was no real middle class, so you had only either the top 10% and especially the top 1% who owned most of the wealth, and the bottom 90% who basically did not own anything. Now, the development of this patrimonial middle class is a very important transformation. And I think a very positive transformation in the long run. But, you know, it's, you still have a bottom 50% of the population that, that has very little. So one of the big questions that I'm asking in my research is, you know, how can we do better than this? How did we have this transformation and what can we do to go further in this direction? Let me also stress that, you know, the fact that you have now this this middle wealth group, just to put numbers on this, you know, if you are 40% of the population and you have about 40% of total wealth, it means that on average you have about the average wealth of the country. So in a country of Western Europe like France or Germany, average wealth today will be about 200,000 euros per adult. You know, average income will be 35,000 euros per year per adult, average national income per adult, and average wealth will be about 6 years of income, about 200,000 euros per adult. So this middle 40% group are people who have 100,000 euros, 200, 300. So they are not enormously rich, you know, from the viewpoint of billionaire or millionaire, you know, 100 or 200,000 euros is almost like zero, you know, it's not much. But in fact, it's a lot more than zero. And this group, this social group, they do own something. Typically, they own their home or they own a little business or a little bit of the two. And, you know, these groups also don't like to be treated like poor people. And the fact that you have today this patrimonial middle class, which is very different from the bottom 50% who own almost zero, also creates political division, you know, which we partly explore in our book with Julia on the history of election in France. You know, in a way, I mean, it's a progress that we have this middle 40% group, but it makes political coalitions also more complicated. In a way, 100 years ago, when all the wealth belonged to the top 10, it was easier for a socialist movement, whatever, to try to put together broad coalition within the bottom 90% because nobody owned anything within the bottom 90%. Now that you have this graduation of wealth within the bottom 90%, creates division, which play a role if you look at who votes for the National Front in France as compared to the left, and you have more homeowners typically. So anyway, I'm not going to enter into this today, but that's also related to lots of political analysis that we develop in our latest book with Julia. Anyway, the main conclusion from this is that, you know, there's pretty extreme concentration of wealth and capital ownership throughout the world, including in Europe. Now, the second important innovation in the World Inequality Report 2022 is the introduction of some indicator of gender inequality, which we can use to compare. Again, the ambition of the World Inequality Database is to have global coverage, to be able to compare different parts of the world. So here you have a very simple indicator, which is what's the share of women in total labor income, including wage income, self-employment income. So in principle, you know, an objective for gender parity should be 50%. Maybe, after all, you know, if you look at the Time Use survey, women contribute to, in fact, more than 50% of total labor time, if you include domestic labor in particular. So, you know, that would be a target. As you can see, we are quite far from this target. So, you know, in Western Europe, this has been increasing, but right now it's a bit more than 35% of total labor income for women, 65% for men. And we believe this gives a view of gender inequality, which is in a way more accurate than when we say, okay, you know, there's a gender gap for a given job or given occupation is 10% or 15%. Because when we do that, you know, it's also a way to minimize the importance of gender inequality, because in practice, of course, people, you know, men and women don't have access to the same job and same occupation for all sorts of reasons. You cannot just look at gender inequality for a given job or a given occupation. And if you look at the complete distribution of labor income, it's a lot more extreme. In the Middle East and North Africa, with very low rate of labor force participation for women, it's going to be less than 20% or less than 15% for women. In Western Europe, back in 1970, it was about 20% for women. So it was almost as small. So this is something that we explore in more details, in particular with access to different strata of the occupational structure in the report. The last dimension of inequality, which we introduce in the World Inequality Report 2022, is inequalities in emission, in carbon emission, and more generally environmental inequality. So what you can see here is that, okay, we all know that there are huge differences in average emission between countries, between the north and the south, but here what we stress are the enormous inequalities within a country. So if you take Europe, so that's an average for all European countries, you know, the bottom 50% of the population who have the lowest carbon emission have emissions of about 5.1 tons per capita right now, which is still too much. You know, the reduction by 2050 should be by about 2 tons. So it has to reduce toward 4, 3, 2 tons. But it's not completely out of line with the objective. The problem is that at the level of the top 10%, you have 29 tons. If you look at the top 1%, you would have almost 100 tons. And in the US, in North America, the top 10% has already 73 tons, and the top 1% almost 200 tons. So it's what this means is that it's going to be impossible to really reduce carbon emission and address environmental challenge if we don't take into account social class and social inequality and carbon emission. Because if you tell these different social groups, okay, we don't care about these inequalities, we want all of you to reduce your carbon emission by the same proportion through a gigantic proportional carbon tax or through a gigantic proportional increase in energy prices, look, you know, people in the bottom, you're going to end up with an enormous yellow vest movement everywhere. You know, people in the bottom are going to tell you, look, I am ready to make effort, you know, if you convince me that this is fair, but to begin with, you have to ask the people who have 30 tons or 70 tons of carbon emission to reduce their emission in a much larger proportion than myself if I have 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. So as long as we don't invent a language to a language of social class into the environmental discussion, there's no way this can work. So this can take the form, you know, you can imagine progressive taxation of carbon emission, like the introduction of progressive income tax in the early 20th century, but I think it goes well beyond this. You know, it's a whole way to look at ecological problems which needs to take into account class inequality and put it at the center much more clearly that we do right now. So now let me go back through history and let me see at a little bit more into the details of the lessons we can draw from the way we have moved toward collectively toward a relatively more equal society over the course of history. So I'm going to tell you a bit more about this book, A Brief History of Equality. Let me say that, so I have written a number of big books on the history of inequality, you know, 3 main books. This one was published in 2001, was really centered on France. This one was published in 2013, takes a more global perspective, but mostly looking at countries in the north. And the last one, Capital and Ideology, was published in 2019 and takes a more global perspective on inequality regime, ideological justification of inequality, the role of colonial legacy, the post-colonial transformation, and takes a more global perspective than Capital in the 21st century. Now, these 3 books, each of them is like 1,000 pages long, so that's 3,000 pages. So, you know, please don't read them, you know, unless you're really very motivated. You can read this one, which is 250 pages, so, you know, you can be read in a weekend or something like that. You can also read the longer one, which, you know, I don't regret that I wrote them. I learned a lot by writing them. But, you know, I think it, for me, this was also very useful, you know, the kind of discussion we're going to have tonight, which I have had in many places over the past 10 years, helped me to rethink, refocus the message, and I think this brief history of inequality tries to get at what I view now as the most important lesson from all of this, with in particular this relatively optimistic perspective on the long run movement toward more equality driven by social struggles, political mobilization, which I think is really the most important lesson. So I'm not going to present the entire book because, you know, I have 10 chapters in the book. Each is about 20 pages long. I start the book with looking at the movement toward more equality in the long run, in particular the slow deconcentration of power and property, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Then there are several chapters on the colonial legacy, the legacy of slavery, the question of reparation, which I'm not going to talk much about today, but I'm happy to answer questions if you want. I will focus more on the what I call here the great redistribution between 1914 and 1980, and the perspective for future new forms of what I call democratic participatory socialism for the future. So let me start with, you know, this movement toward more equality in the long run, which I have been talking about. So let me start with income. So basically, this is what I have told you already when I have shown you the world map. If you look at a country like France, which is quite representative of Western Europe in general, you can see that in the long run, there's a decline, a quite significant decline in the share of the top 10%, which was like 50-55% in the 19th century, like Latin America today, and which is today more 30-35%. The bottom 50% used to be a little more than 10%, it's now 20-25%. This includes transfer income like pension income, unemployment insurance, but this does not include the income tax itself and the in-kind transfer in the form of access to health and education in particular. If we include all the redistribution through in-kind transfer progressive tax, the movement toward more equality will be even more spectacular. So this is a significant movement. Okay, so something happened. If we have to subscribe to something, maybe we need a credit card number if someone has. So anyway, we've seen the okay. Well, that's going to come back. So it will come back. I'm sure. Yes. So this was the evolution of income inequality in the long run, which has become, you know, relatively more equal in the long run. Now, for wealth, yes. Well, I have it on the computer, but not yet. Yeah. You think there's a way to... Oh, yes. Yeah, we are. Yeah. So this was for income inequality, where we see a significant movement toward more equality in the long run. Now, this is for wealth inequality. So you can see that the movement toward equality was much more limited. So that's what I told you before. You know, the bottom 50% today in France owns 6% of total wealth. In Europe, on average, it's 4%. Okay, this is better than in the 19th century, you know, at the time of Balzac or Emile Zola, where it will be 1 or 2%. But, you know, 5 or 6% as compared to 1 or 2, when you are 50% of the population, that's not very large. Now, it is true that the middle 40% has gained tremendously. You know, they used to have 10-15% of total wealth. Now they have 40, and the top 10 has declined significantly. You can see that in the 1980s, the movement toward equality has started to go a little bit in the other direction. It's not a huge return backward in the case of France or European countries. In the US, the return backward has been much stronger. But still, it's quite striking to see that, you know, the share of the middle 40% you know, is now declining a little bit. The share of the top 10 is increasing, which means that for the new generation, you know, access to homeownership in particular, to basic properties, actually more complicated than for their parents' generation, and that's something, you know, which is quite striking as compared to the long run evolution. So that's that's quite an important finding. So now the question is, how do we do better than this? And first, how did we get to relatively more equal in the long run? Well, it's important to realize that until World War I, there was relatively limited movement toward more equality of income or wealth. So in particular, if you look at, you know, different European societies before World War I, so here I put France, Britain, Sweden, you can see that it was very extreme inequality pretty much everywhere. And, you know, it's interesting. So Britain was particularly unequal. Sweden was sort of in between. It's interesting to see that because, you know, sometime today we look at, for instance, at a country like Sweden as a country that is, you know, social democratic, very equal country, at least as compared to other countries. But in fact, it's not always been like that. In fact, if you go back 100 years ago, Sweden was extremely unequal with an incredibly unequal political system. So, you know, Sweden, until World War I, in this period, you know, 1818 to 1914, only the top 20% of the population had the right to vote, and only top 20% of men, of course. Women did not have the right to vote. And within the top 20% of men, you could have between 100 vote or you could have between one vote or 100 votes, you know, depending on how wealthy you are. So the wealthiest people had as much as 100 votes individually, and that was for national election, legislative election. In municipal elections, there was no upper limit in the number of votes you can have, so it will keep rising with the amount of tax you pay. And so you had several dozen municipalities in Sweden, you know, until World War I, where only one individual had more than 50% of the vote. So you were a perfectly legal dictator, and even companies had the right to vote in municipal election in Sweden at that time, in proportion again to the tax you pay in the municipality. So, you know, which is something multinational today, they would love to have this, you know, in the countries in which they invest, but they don't even dare asking for that. I mean, sometimes they find other ways to get the same outcome, but the fact that they don't dare asking for that, it's already a significant transformation. Now, this was Sweden, you know, until World War I. And so when we think today, when we imagine that there are some countries that have a sort of permanent culture of equality, like Sweden, and some others who have a permanent culture of inequality, like India, you know, this doesn't work like this. Political mobilization can actually transform equality and class relationship very fast. So in the case of Sweden, what's very striking is, you know, you had enormous labor union mobilization, which pushed for universal suffrage. The Social Democratic Party took power in 1932 and put the state capacity of the country to the service of a completely different project. So the registration of income and wealth, instead of being used to distribute voting rights, was used to make people to pay high progressive tax in proportion to their income and wealth, and to pay for a system of school and education and health, which, you know, is not perfect. And, you know, we've seen with COVID all the limitations of our health system, but which still much better than anything we had seen before. And so this shows also how the state in itself is not a force that goes for more equality or for more inequality. It depends who controls the state and what, how you use the state capacity to put it to the service of a different project. And this can change in this example of Sweden in the context of 10 or 20 years through very large grassroots mobilization in the case of Sweden. So, you know, that's very striking to see, generally speaking, you know, how this distribution can change, and in the particular case of Europe, how unequal it was everywhere You know, including in France. So France is yet another story. You know, France, there's a long narrative of describing France as a country, you know, in love with equality forever. In fact, under the Third Republic at that time, you know, France was the very last country, in fact, to create the income tax that was voted in the summer of 1914. And this was not to pay for schools. This was to pay to go to war with Germany. You know, this is the only thing that made the French Senate under the Third Republic accept the income tax. And one of the justification at the time for not having an income tax in France was to say, you know, in France, we've made the French Revolution. So, you know, we're already a country of equals. We don't need income tax. You know, Britain, which is a very aristocratic country, they need an income tax. Germany, very authoritarian, unequal, they need an income tax. But France, we are already a country of equals. Well, except that this is what we find in the inheritance archives. And, you know, in Paris in particular, you know, the top 1% alone in Paris in 1914 has more than 70% of total wealth and total inheritance transmitted to their children. So for me, you know, going through this historical data was a very strong experience because it sort of showed me, you know, the powerful imagination of elite sometimes, you know, to justify their position, either in Sweden with this incredible voting institution that I just described, or France with this narrative about, you know, the country of equals that doesn't need an income tax. So I think it's important to be very critical about this narrative. And, you know, looking at this 100 years ago is, of course, easier in some ways than today, but we need to have the same critical perspective today. So anyway, this was the situation 100 years ago. Now, you can see that Europe between 1913 and 2020 has become a bit more equal in the sense that you have, again, this middle class in wealth, which has gained strength. In the US, it's sort of intermediate between Europe 1913 and Europe 2020. And it has been going really in the wrong direction since the 1980s with a very significant decline in the share of the middle class, which used to be in 1980 close to Europe today, you know, close to 35-40%, and that is now 25%. And so this is showing how these transformations are also reversible. You know, they are not, there's a long run trend toward more equality, but it's limited in size and it should not be taken as given. Now, how did we get there in the long run, and what was the most important institutional transformation that made a number of societies a bit more equal today than what they were 100 years ago? Probably the most important transformation is what I call here the rise of the social state, which you could call the rise of the welfare state, except that I include here education and other public services, which are sometimes not included when we look at the welfare state, strictly speaking. So you can see, so this is how European countries, so here this is an average of Germany, France, Britain, Sweden. You have some variation between countries, obviously, but by and large, this is the same long-run pattern. And you can see how the total tax revenue before World War I was less than 10% of national income. Most of it was used to pay for law and order, basically the army, the police. I mean, the military itself was like 4% of national income at the time, like in the US today, so, and which itself was used for military expansion, colonial expansion. So that there was very little social spending. You know, in particular, if you look at educational spending before World War I, it's less than 0.5% of national income in all European countries. In the US at the time, it's 1% of national income. So there is an educational advance in the US as compared to Europe, but it's quite small everywhere. Today, so you don't see the numbers with the purple color, but it's 6% of national income in education. So it has been multiplied by 10 as compared to 0.5% before World War I, and you have a huge increase in health spending, in pension spending, other social spending, and this transformation has made European societies more equal and at the same time more prosperous. In particular, the rise of education is the chief explanation behind the rise of economic productivity in the long run. You can also see the stagnation of educational investment in recent decades. So this is what you can call the sort of the neoliberal stagnation or the neoliberal new frozen plateau, if you want, where the sort of new narrative starting in the 1980s, 90s has been to say, okay, we have to stop somewhere, let's stop right there. Which, you know, I can understand the logic of the argument, except that if you have a rising fraction of the population going to higher education, and you know, today it will be 50-60% of a generation in these European countries going to higher education. It was 20% in the 1980s, 2% in 1950. And if you stabilize the total educational spending, you know, it means that you will actually reduce the educational investment per student, which is probably not the best way to prepare the future. And same thing for health. You know, if you stabilize total health spending and at the same time you have aging, you have new technological discovery, then you're going to cut on the number of doctors. You're going to create a lot of frustration, and you're going to let the room for private health spending, private education spending, and you know, there's very little evidence that the private sector, in particular in health and education, is doing a better job than the public sector. If you look, you know, right now in the US, the health sector is almost 20% of GDP, with public health indicators which are absolutely catastrophic. So what's the point of spending 20% of GDP with such public health indicators? So, you know, I think in the end, we should be clear about the fact that this positive transformation should continue in the long run, which requires a lot of imagination to better organize this public sector through a more decentralized organization of universities, of doctors, hospitals, social sectors, environmental sectors, through a more equitable tax system, because it's very difficult to put more collective resources into the social state if the tax system is viewed as non-equitable. And that's really the other important lesson from the 20th century, that this big expansion of collective resources into the social state was possible because this was also a time where progressive taxation became very important. So this is the evolution of the average tax rate, you know, paid by the entire population as a fraction of national income. But now if you look at tax progressivity, so you know, this is the top income tax rate applying to the highest income level. And so you can see, you know, before World War I, there was almost no income tax, and France in purple had no income tax before 1914. I already told you the story. Then you can see after World War I and in the 30s, after the election of Roosevelt in the US, the US is going to go to top income tax rate of 80-90%. And, you know, between 1930 and 1980, so during half a century, on average, the US has a top income tax rate of 81%. And this is only the federal income tax. You have state income tax in California, New York, which are typically 5-10%. You know, apparently this did not destroy American capitalism, you know, otherwise we would have noticed it. So, I know it's very difficult to have a quiet discussion about taxation, you know, when people get very excited very fast, but, you know, that's part of our historical legacy. And what I would argue, after a careful examination of all the historical evidence we have, is that this was actually a very successful historical experiment. Now, we are in the social sciences. People can come with other information, other analyses. We should have an open democratic discussion about that. But, you know, it's important to look at this evidence. And with the evidence I have, what I know, I think this was a very successful experiment in the sense that this reduced the income scale enormously. This had no negative consequences for incentives or productivity growth. You know, I'm not saying you can have complete equality. You know, maybe you want an income scale of 1-5, 1-10. I think 1-5 is enough. But in any case, 1-50 or 1-100 or 1-200, like the kind of income scale we have today, You know, to me, if I compare the different time period countries, it's simply not useful. And in particular, when you had this enormous top tax rate of 80-90% that were applied, you know, mostly in the top 1% of income, so typically people who would make more than 20, 30, 40 times average income. In fact, they were compressed enormously. This did not hurt productivity growth in the US, probably because also the key difference is that the US had an educational advantage, and what this shows is that the key determinant of economic prosperity in the long run is education and relatively broad-based access to education. And I know it can seem strange to say that today, but in fact, until the middle of the 20th century, the US had a relatively more equal access to education than in many European countries. There were huge racial disparities, of course, but in the 1950s, you have 80-90% of a generation going to high school in the US. At the same time, it's only 20-30% in Germany or France or Japan. And you have to wait until the 1980s to have quasi-universal access to high school in Western Europe and in Japan. And I think that's the main explanation for the, you know, the big educational, the big productivity advance of the U.S. and in the end, why the U.S. was a economic leader over most of the 20th century. You know, military factors and power systems are also very important. But the you know, I think we should not forget that, you know, the key role of education for productivity. If you after the 1980s, you know, the strategy of Reagan was to say, okay, we're going to destroy progressive taxation. We're going to cut tremendously the top tax rate. Maybe this will raise inequality, but this will also raise productivity, innovation, economic growth so much. You know, the size of the pie is going to increase so fast that the average Americans will have enormous income growth and wage growth. The problem is that this is not at all what we've seen. So, in fact, if you look at the evolution of the growth rate, so in green, you have the growth rate of per capita national income in the US, which was actually divided by two after the Reagan decade. So you reduce the top tax rate of the income tax by two, but you're supposed to boost economic growth, but in fact you divide the income tax by the growth rate by two. By the way, I'm not saying that the growth rate was divided by two because the tax rate was divided by two. I think the real factor is more the stagnation of educational investment since the 1980s, 1990s that explain this decline in economic growth. But at least, you know, what we should all agree upon is that, you know, destroying the progressive income tax of Roosevelt in itself is not a strategy that brings more innovation, more growth. You know, clearly we don't see that at all in the historical experiment. And I think this failure of neoliberalism under Reagan is really one of the big explanations for the transformation of the Republican Party in the US and the rise of neo-nationalism, you know, because Trump, but this could have been someone else at the top of the Republican Party, after, you know, 3 decades after Reagan, the average American did not see the huge increase in income and wages that they were supposed to have with neoliberal globalization. So you have to find new people to blame. You have to blame the Mexican, you have to blame China, you have to blame the Muslim, you have to, you know, there's always lots of people you can blame for. And this is becoming really ugly. And it's not only in the US, you know, the rise of neo-nationalism in my country, in France, I heard in Serbia that it's not always so simple. And you know, there are lots of countries where, you know, the failure of neoliberalism tends to feed, you know, this kind of discourse where you need to find, you know, other people to blame for this failure. And that's a big part of our political malfunctioning today, to say the least, have to do with this failure. Now, how do we move ahead for the future? Let me first say that, you know, here I'm describing a system based on the idea of redistribution of inheritance, which, you know, I'm not saying this is going to happen next week, but, you know, I think if we look at long-run possible evolution of our economic and social system, I think that must be part of the discussion. So what do I do here? I start from the distribution of inheritance today. So today in Europe, the bottom 50% of children receive about 5% of total inheritance, whereas the top 10% children receive 55% of inheritance. This will be roughly the kind of number in Serbia today. That's what you have in France, in most European countries, or even more extreme than this. Here, the simulation is just to say, okay, let's redistribute inheritance by giving to everybody at age 25 €120,000. Well, here this corresponds to 60% of average inheritance, which will be €200,000. And this is paid for by a mixture of progressive inheritance tax and progressive wealth tax. So to be concrete, people who receive zero or close to zero, they would receive €120,000. People who today receive €1 million, which is the average in the top 10%, would receive 600,000. So, you know, you are still far from full equality of opportunity. And, you know, if you want my opinion, we could go further than this. But, you know, what's very striking is that when you make this kind of proposal on the table, you know, you have lots of people who pretend they are in favor of equal rights, equal opportunities. You know, they look at this and say, oh, but, you know, these poor children, you know, they are going to do many stupid things with the money if you do that. You know, as if rich children, you know, never make stupid things with the money they receive, you know. And I think here it's a... You know, it's sort of one of the contradictions of today's sort of proprietarian ideology, which we get accustomed to a sort of sacralization of the transmission of property rights, including enormous level of property accumulation, which make very little sense to me. Now, I'm not saying this is going to happen next week. I should also stress that in my view, you know, this should come in addition to an expansion of the social state. So, you know, this is only a small part of what should a fair society look like. You know, the total cost of this is about 5% of national income. So as compared, you know, the total size of the social state today is more 45-50% of national income in Sweden or France or Germany. And maybe in the future it should be 60% or 70%. And so this universal inheritance component, say 5% of national income, is not going to be the magic solution. You know, it's just a small addition, and it should certainly not replace access to education, access to health, workers' rights in companies, basic income. So the issue of basic income was mentioned a couple of times earlier. Let me say that, you know, basic income in a way already exists in many Western European countries, where people can get €500 per month, €400, €600, you know, say between 50-60% of full-time minimum wage as a minimal income. It could be improved. It could be made more universal, it could be distributed more automatically, but it will always be a relatively small amount. By definition, it will be smaller than full-time minimum wage, which itself is not very high. So, you know, this cannot be the magic bullet. It's good to have a basic income. I think having basic inheritance in addition to basic income makes a big difference, because again, having, you know, the it's more than just money. You know, when you own €100,000 or €200,000, it gives you a stronger bargaining position for yourself, you know, vis-à-vis your own life and vis-à-vis the rest of society. When you own zero, or when you only have debt, you are in a very weak bargaining position. Basically, you need to accept any job you are being offered, any wage, any working condition, because you need to pay for your rent. If you have children, you need to cater for them. If you own 100, 200, you know, you can start to negotiate your life better. You can buy a home. You don't need to pay a rent. You can take more risk in your professional career. You can start a business, whatever. And I think it will make a more dynamic society, a more innovating society. Now, again, that's not going to happen next week, next year. But if we think of the long-run construction of the social state in the 20th century, and we think about next transformation in the 21st century. You know, that will be part of the target together with better access to education and health. Let me now come to the conclusion. I think I have already passed my time. But with the question of access to education, which together with redistribution of inheritance, I think is really the central issue. So this is inequality of access to higher education in the US right now. So here you have the percentile of parental income, and here you have the probability to access university. And you see it's quite striking, you know, it's almost the 45 degree line. So not completely, you know, if your parents are poor, you still have a 25% chance to go to university, and if your parents are rich, you only have a 95% chance to go to university. So it doesn't go from 0 to 100, it goes from 25 to 95%. But this is still quite striking. And what this and in fact it's even worse than that, because if you are here, you don't go at all to the same universities than if you are over there. So in fact this is underestimating the magnitude of inequality. But what this shows is that, you know, okay, you have a theoretical discourse about equal opportunity, et cetera, which everybody is supposed to agree with, and then you have a reality which can be quite different. So I think it's important, like for inequality measurement, you know, to have some explicit indicator and put, you know, pressure on government and various groups about, you know, where we want to go, and to go away from abstract discourse on equal opportunity and ask, you know, is this the best we can do? Where do we want to go, and how can we track the evolution? So, you know, I should say, by the way, that, you know, this is particularly extreme in the US because you have private universities with high tuition fees, but you also have a lot of hypocrisy and a lot of inequality in many publicly funded systems, including in my own country, in France, where, you know, if you look at how much, so this is a different way to look at inequality in education in France, where I rank children by their position in how much total educational investment they receive from kindergarten to university. And so on average, so these are for the people who are born in 2000 and who were 20 in 2020. So that's the same age as student, if there are students in the room, roughly. And so I don't know for Serbia how it would look like, but anyway, for France, the average spending is 120,000 euros. But then you have people at the top who get 200, 250. So this will be, in the French context, people going to the most selective schools called the Grande École in the French system, which get more public money per student than the normal university track, which will be in the middle of the distribution. And people at the bottom are people who don't go for higher education and who exit the school system at age 17 or 18. So in the end, and this is only public spending. So the system of public spending for education, in effect, is exacerbating initial inequality. So again, the question is this the best we can do? Now, the good news, and I want to conclude, and this will be the last slide I will show you, is that in the long run, there has been some progress. So in particular, here I put as a comparison point a very extremely unequal society, which is a colonial society, and I took the example of Algeria in 1950, where you can see that the inequality in educational investment was much, much bigger. And today, France 2020, you know, looks like almost very equal, more equal than France 1910 and a lot more equal than Algeria 1950. Now, why is this interesting? Because this also shows, again, the imagination sometimes of societies and political and economic elite, you know, to organize very equal society. So in the case of Algeria 1950, basically, who are the top 10%? They are the children of the settlers, so you have about 10 to 13% of the population of Algeria, which is made of European and mostly French colonizers in 1950. And they have a separate school system, completely separate school system. You have a school system for the white children and a school system for the Muslim Algerian. And if you look at the budgetary archives of the French colonial empire, you actually find the budget going to the different schools, and this is what you get. And you know, it's very striking because, you know, sometimes in my country, in France, you know, when we talk about racial segregation and things, you know, some people tend to say, oh, you know, this is a US reality. You know, in France, we never had any segregation. Well, okay, you go to the French colonial empire, you know, on the other side of the Mediterranean Sea, and this is what you get. You have completely separated school and completely different budget. This was all paid by tax paid by the colonized population, which was the tax system, which was mostly indirect tax paid by the poorest group, and then this is how the money was used, which of course to perpetuate inequality is a very strong powerful tool. You know, if you put 80% of the school budget for 10% of the children, you know now as compared to this, you know, even France in 1910 looks very equal, although this was in fact an incredibly elitist school system, where basically most of the population would only go to primary school, and only 10% of the population would really go to high school, and even less would go to higher education. So, you know, the share for the top 10% was only 2 times or 1.5 times the share of the bottom 50%. But of course, the top 10% is 5 times smaller; it's 5 times less numerous than the share of the bottom 50%. So, in fact, the gap in per student spending was enormous. And even today, today looks like incredibly equal. So, you know, in the long run, yes, there has been a movement toward a lot more equality. Except that, again, you know, the top 10%, it is 5 times smaller a group than the bottom 50%. So the fact that their share in total educational spending is twice as small, in fact, they have much bigger spending per student. In fact, this is exactly the same data as this one. You know, so you have, in fact, enormous inequality. So this is just to say, and to conclude this talk, that in the long run, we have a movement toward more equality. That's in all dimensions, income, wealth, education, you know, gender equality. But, you know, there is still a very long way to go. And I think the example of education and access to wealth, you know, makes us very clear that, you know, we're still in a situation which doesn't look at all consistent with the basic principles of equal rights, which we pretend to base our societies upon. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you so much for making this accessible and understandable for all of us. I'm going to leave it to Professor Zarkovic for a few questions and then pass it back to me so I can get questions from the audience.
Yeah. Well, it's not only a few questions, sorry. Yeah. Okay, I also waited for this moment for, 8 years, maybe more, sorry. Well, and my students maybe even longer, you know, they're overwhelmed with your text. I mean, even before Capital in the First 21st Century, you know, was published in Serbian. So thank you for this lecture. It was great, as always, I would say. So, as you can see, there are many people in Serbia who like these left-wing ideas. Joseph Stiglitz was here, you know, a couple of years ago, and he's very popular. But I predict that Thomas Piketty will have even higher number of fans in Serbia, you know. And I advised you, in fact, maybe to start with this book, A Brief History of Equality, because your books are really voluminous, both Capital in the 21st Century and now Capital and Ideology, but maybe you can start with this one. Why? As you said at the beginning, this is a very optimistic book. I think the usage of the word equality instead of inequality is really optimistic. And as you said, like, the main message is that we've been moving towards greater and greater inequality, right, during the at least last 2 centuries, but even longer. And of course, Okay, you didn't have time to present all of the policy proposals that you discussed them in more detail in this book, also Capital in the 21st Century. But I know that you're aware that many fellow economists think that your proposals, well, some of them are maybe even utopian, right? And that we will need lots of years or even decades to reach some of the proposals that you suggest. But do you agree? So this is, in fact, a kind of observation maybe and a question to you, that during the pandemic, we tried some of the policies that you suggest, like, well, governments in many countries in Europe and beyond were just, you know, giving people money without imposing any strict conditionality. In United States, in Spain, I think also in Japan, it was something like universal basic income. They were just giving people money and it had good effects. Also, in 2021, I think there was this G7 countries proposed introduction of this global tax on multinationals of at least 15%. Why? To reduce their incentives to move their profits in tax havens, right? In these offshore tax havens. So do you agree that it was a kind, the pandemic was a terrible thing, but in terms of the public policies and policies that you discuss in your books and that are aimed at reducing inequality, right, that was a kind of really positive momentum. And there some discussions even started, in these international public policy circles that maybe, so that there are good features of going towards a more universal, as you said, there is basic income in almost all European countries, but it's really rather small. We could see from your slide that the spending, right, the public spending on social transfers was rising until 1980, right, when Thatcher and Reagan came to power, but then there's a more or less constant spending since then, and that's been like for the last 30, 40 years.
So do I agree that recent evolution sort of continue in the direction in a way of more equality? Yes, to some extent, I agree with the fact that, this movement in the long run toward more equality, is driven by enormous social and political demand and will continue. Now, in the case of the pandemic, I will be... what's interesting, at least, is to see that confronted with new crises, government, public opinion, and economists who are sometimes very conservative. Economists 100 years ago, they thought, many of them thought that progressive taxation was impossible, and then it was implemented. You have seen in the U.S. and things worked very well. So, when crises come. Many observers that were very conservative beforehand, they have to find solution. And so after 2008, they start printing money like crazy, which before they said they would never do. Now, I'm not sure they did it well, but at least, and it's like the pandemic, already before Biden, Trump had this budget where they give, $4,000 per month to millions of people. When you face new challenges, you have to invent new solutions. And I think this is going to be the same in the future with the climate crisis. As catastrophic climate events become more and more visible to the public, governments will have to find solutions. And I think the tolerance for extreme inequality, is very fragile. And in particular, the tolerance for, people taking their private jet all the time and giving lessons to the rest of the population about what to do, this is a very fragile situation and this can disappear very fast. So yes, things can change and will continue to change.
Okay, so the other question, you didn't cover that in your talk, but I think it's important for the audience here in Serbia, because Serbia is an EU candidate country, well, for more than 10 years. Yeah, that's been a long time. But with the war in Ukraine, unfortunately, I think that this idea, of EU enlargement is again gaining ground, unfortunately, because of the war. But they are now talking about maybe, accepting the whole Western Balkans together with Ukraine. But there are some things in your book, which I think, I want to ask you, suggesting that maybe this would be hard to achieve. Why? You argue that there is a kind of, you call that like that, divorce between disadvantaged classes in the EU and the construction of the European Union, the whole European project. And you have nice examples in your book. I'm talking now about capital and ideology. You mention referendum about the Maastricht Treaty in 1992. Again, the referendum in 2005 about the European Constitution, right? And you present the data for France, and you say that in both of these cases, those that are at the bottom, more or less, bottom of the income distribution with less educational level of education, they were voting against both of those treaties, whereas those that with higher income, higher wealth, with higher level of education, they voted massively yes. And you also mentioned Brexit, which was like, compared to these two votes, it was like decades apart and in different countries, but you observe the same trend, right? So that these that are like belonging to the lower classes or lower middle classes, that you call them disadvantaged, are in fact not in favor of the European project. And I would guess, if that time comes when they need to vote of the new EU enlargement, they would be the ones against the enlargement. So what's your explanation for that, as you call it, divorce between the disadvantaged classes in the European Union and the whole European project?
Well, I think this has to do with the way the European project was constructed and developed to begin with. But, it's not what I want to say also is that it's not a frozen project. It can still change. It can still be transformed from the inside. And, I hope Serbia one day will contribute to change it from the inside. So it's not, it's like social democracy. It's not a finished product. It's not something we should take as given and just protect for the rest of time. And in the case of the European Union, it has to be transformed tremendously. The problem of the key problem of the European Union for me is that instead of trying to build some common political sovereignty to regulate economic forces and to regulate capitalism, the European Union has built itself around some kind of quasi-sacralization of the principles of free capital flows, market competition, and in fact making it even impossible sometimes for national government to put restrictions on these principles in the name of higher goals if you want to have a proper transportation policy or energy policy. So, we see here what the sacralization of the market for energy is doing to energy prices in Europe these past 2 years, and then all governments have to pay for enormous energy subsidies in order to compensate for the fact that the market price is going to the sky, generating enormous profits for certain energy providers whose costs did not increase. This whole sacralization of the market process, when we think of energy, when we think of transportation, is just not working. And so this will have to change. And, given the climate objective and the environmental challenges, I think this will have to change pretty fast. So let's take an example. The European Commission took a decision a few months ago, to put in place carbon adjustment mechanism at the frontier, which is supposed to be basically a carbon tax for imports coming from China or from other territories who emit more carbon emission when they produce, battery for cars, for electric engines, etc. The problem is that this, this carbon tax that was divided so far is so ridiculously small. You know, it will be the equivalent by 2030. It will raise for at the whole level of the European Union the equivalent of 2% of the total imports from China. And if you look at total imports from all over the world, less than 1%. This is not going to change anything, and you're going to keep, you know, destroying industrial jobs in Europe because you don't have the same rules in terms of environmental protection, in terms of social obligation, tax obligation. This simply cannot work. So, you know, I would like a European system where you can, and that's because of unanimity rule for taxation, that's because of impossibility to take decision with a majority rule decision making, in particular for taxation. I would like one day, you know, Europe, and you know, I have contributed to a manifesto for the democratization of Europe, where a smaller number of willing countries should be able, you know, to vote with a majority rule system, a common tax on high wealth, high income, carbon content for import. But we cannot wait, you know, for the unanimity or even the majority of European countries to agree to do that. So I think individual countries will have to take unilateral decisions to have a protection measures. You know, if you think, to take a very concrete example, the electric car sector. If countries don't do that, you know, it will be 100% Chinese cars in 10 years in Europe, which makes no sense
even
at
now,
all. So it's, you know, this way, I think the pressure to change the system are going to be very big. Now, I think this should not prevent, Serbia of Ukraine from joining the club, because, you know, the European Union is already so complicated to govern with 27. You know, I don't think being 30 or 31 will make any difference. What's important is within the club of 30 countries to have the possibility for subgroup of countries. So maybe it will start with Germany, France, Italy, and Serbia. You know, why not? I don't know. To have some more, maybe not socialist Europe, but at least some common tax policy to begin with, in order to regulate capitalism and to transform capitalism rather than just follow the market ideology. Let me say that, you know, there was a time in the 70s until the early 80s where there was some pretty advanced discussion in Europe, you know, to have, for instance, a directive that was pushed by the German Social Democrat government at the time in the 70s to have a common co-determination rules in the board of company all across Europe. So you know that in Germany, so it's not exactly the Yugoslavian experiment with self-management, but this is another example where you have 50% of the seats in the boards of large companies in Germany, which go to workers' representatives. It's not a perfect system because at the end of the day, the shareholders always have 50% plus one of the vote. So sometimes, you know, it's a sort of fake system where the workers are supposed to have more power, but in fact, at the time of the decisive decision, you know, they are in a minority. Except that I think, you know, this is the beginning of something interesting because if, in addition, workers have 20% of the capital of the company, or if a regional government has 20% of the share of the company, then you can make the majority change in the governing of the company, even if you have a shareholder with 80% of the capital. And I can tell you, from a point of view of a shareholder, you know, this is like communism. You know, this is a completely crazy system. But, you know, this is the system that has been in place in Germany since 1951, and apparently this did not destroy German capitalism, just like the 90% tax rate of Roosevelt did not destroy US capitalism. So I think, you know, it's important to start from this experience and to remember in the European context, because this was your question, that in the 70s, at some point, it was very close to have a European directive imposing this system for all European companies. And then it would have been, you know, a different kind of social Europe, because this would have set a norm, which then could have been copied in other part of the world. You know, today this system only exists in Germany, Sweden, Austria, you know, a few Nordic countries, but it does not exist in UK, US, France. So, you know, for other parts of the world, in Brazil, India, whatever, you know, they don't care that this system exists in Germany, you know, but if it was all of Europe, you know, this could have become a new global norm. And then you can go even further and reduce shareholder voting rights to less than 50%, also, I think, in larger companies. Now, why was it not implemented in the 70s? It was very close. I think the problem partly was that the different socialist party and social democratic party in Europe were actually unable to fully agree. In particular, the socialist party in France at the time was not too interested in you know, self-management or co-management of companies. They wanted to nationalize everything in 1981, so they said to the German, oh, you know, you are really soft social democrats. We want to nationalize everything in 1981. But then they abandoned all nationalization policies and went for a free capital flow, a Maastricht Treaty, and forgot about self-management and everything. And I, you know, I think it would have been probably better to agree with the German social democrats at the time. The Labour Party in Britain also at the time was more interested in nationalization than self-management. Also, the Germans were very obsessed with having everywhere their you know, particular governance system of company with two different boards, with the supervisory board and the management board, which cannot, you know, it's not necessarily the best system. So anyway, what I mean is that if we want to build a different kind of Europe, we need international coalition with a policy platform of transformation, which, you know, can really transform you know, capitalism in a structural manner. And so far, you know, I would say that the sort of pro-business camp and the market forces, you know, have been stronger at setting the agenda and at formulating a common platform than the, you know, social democratic and socialist and left parties. But it's not a frozen situation. Again, if you go back through history, you know, there were some missed opportunities, but, you know, there will be other opportunities.
Great, thank you. I know that many people from the audience will have more questions. I just, Zona, please, one more, just 1 minute, because from your slide, I even didn't know that you have that in World Inequality Database, and as you said, it's completely new, female labor income share, right? So that's really great, and even I've seen this carbon inequality, right? So that's something new. I just wanted, because of the audience, this year, Nobel Prize winner in economics is Claudia Goldin. She's Harvard professor, and she received Nobel Prize for her research into gender inequality in the labor market. And I'm really happy that you shared this. It's very interesting, in fact, as you could see, Russia and Central Asia, right, in your graph, are the closest to this gender parity, which of course is a communist legacy, right? This is also for potential readers of your book. You discuss how, well, in France, and you say that in US is the same situation. If you observe this evolution of number of women that are among the top income earners, right? So like in 1995, I think only 10% of those in the top 1% were women. And then 20 years after, that share increased from 10 to only 16%, right? So it's really, I mean, it's like an improvement, but it's really, really, really slow. So even in Western societies, right, that are deemed as more progressive, so this climb in the social ladder of women is in fact quite slow. So if you want to comment that, if not, I mean, readers can find that in your book. How do you explain that?
Well, just a quick addition to what you just said. It's indeed, the slope is very slow. The evolution is very slow. So if we were to continue at the same speed, we would need to wait until 2120 to get 50% of women in the top 1%. So if we don't want to wait that long, you know, we need to do something else. It's like for wealth deconcentration and the redistribution of inheritance. You know, if you're happy with this situation, don't do anything. But if you're unhappy, you have to find something else. Something else has to do with some form of shares of women in certain occupation, you know, like what was done for members of parliament in a number of countries. Let me just add that it was in this case, in many countries, including in France, you know, it required enormous political fight and enormous, in this case, constitutional transformations. The constitutional court first put its veto on several legislation passed by the socialist government in 1981 to have a minimum share for women in parliament, and it was impossible to reform the constitution because you need the approval of the French Senate, which is structurally right-wing because of the way it is elected. So you had to wait for the French Senate to agree, like for the income tax in 1914. This came in 2008. And now it's only the beginning to have some possibility for legislation to actually monitor the share of women not only in parliament but also in top earning occupation. So this takes very big political fight, in some case constitutional transformation, and this will be the same for the even more for the redistribution of wealth, which I have indicated, which, you know, this looks simple when you describe it like that, but the resistance by property owners, including on the form of legal defense and constitutional imagination to try to pretend that it is illegal to go toward more equality, we should not neglect the amount of resistance on this side.
Great, thank you so much. Now the audience, I hope you took pictures, right?
Okay, we took a bit longer than planned, but let's start. I see a question here.
Thank you, Professor Piketty, for being here with us and for the inspiring lecture. So I have a rather general question. So throughout the book, you mentioned that you are an optimist, that you believe that, you know, there is this promise of participatory socialism which will come about, which we didn't hear that much. But what I wanted to know, and I also appreciate the fact that you see this progress of equality as a social struggle. It comes about through social struggles. But then again, that means that we need social engagement, and when you have social engagement, you can also have failures. So my question is, what kind of transformation of capitalism awaits us if we fail to deliver the promise of participatory socialism, especially if we have in mind that other authors are speaking about techno-feudalism that is around the corner, or, for example, you yourself mentioned that the other model is the Chinese dystopian socialism. So what are your thoughts on this?
Well, let me try not to be too long. We should stop, I think, before everybody wants to leave, given the time. So, I think there are lots of possible dystopian future. You know, the Chinese sort of digital surveillance system is one of them. The Elon Musk model owning Twitter, or lots of media, or owning the satellite system to control, military affairs in Ukraine, or whatever. You know, I think that there are so many dystopian futures. You know, I told you about the Swedish dystopian past of 1910, where even corporations have the right to vote in municipal election. That's crazy dystopian past, but, you know, this could also become, you know, some kind of dystopian future, you know, to protect investment. You imagine some new ways to prevent, normal people from participating to decision making. I mean, it will not take the same form as the censitary society of the 19th century, because it will really look bad, but, you know, you can have some imagination to get the same outcome. So, okay, there are lots of dystopian future. Now, I think the forces of resistance to this are very strong, and I don't think this will happen so easily. Basically, to make, to continue the transformation of the economic system that we've seen in the past century, there are two key ingredients. One is the weaknesses of the capitalist camp, and the other one is the strengths of the socialist camp, if you want. So weaknesses of the capitalist camp has always been, you know, the capacity of the different capitalist elite to fight against each other. And, you know, of course, the World War One and the big fight between the capitalist class of France, Britain, Germany was the beginning of the end of that kind of order, because so now, as of now, we still have, I think, a high level of class solidarity among the oligarchs of and billionaires of the West and billionaires of Russia and China. And I think one of the reasons why we didn't put meaningful sanctions on Russian oligarchs' investment in Paris, London, Courchevel, or Monaco, etc., is because, I mean, it's perfectly doable from a technical viewpoint, but if we develop the organization to do it, then, you know, I think Western billionaires and oligarchs will be next on the list, and so they don't want to develop this kind of organization partly for that. So you have this kind of class solidarity, but it is still fragile, because from geopolitical reason, you know, at some point, and with the new environmental challenges, you know, I think this, you know, we live in a very particular time period where this system of free capital flows, which was developed particularly in Europe with the Maastricht Treaty and then spread to, you know, to IMF guidelines and to the rest of the world, is still with us, but it's getting under attack. And so at some point, I think this international class solidarity of billionaires, you know, will break down, and so that will be the weakening of the capitalist camp. And then, on the socialist camp, you know, it's more complicated, because we're just out of a major historical disaster, which you know very well in ex-Yugoslavia, which is the failure of you know, Soviet communism and Eastern Europe forms of communism, and you know, it's still quite recent in the end, you know. So and it created in the 1990s and 2000, you know, a climate of discouragement about transformation of the economic system. This was exploited by, you know, neoliberal forces, and, you know, to get rid of any form of progressive taxation in many Eastern European countries. You know, in Russia and China today, you privatize everything to oligarchs, and then you don't have, you have a 0% inheritance tax. So, you know, you can transmit your wealth to the next generation paying no tax. You know, even in the US or in Japan or in Germany or in Britain or in France, you pay an inheritance tax of 30, 40, 50%. And today, you know, in East Asia, you should go and die in communist China, you know, if you want to transfer your wealth to your dynasty with zero tax. If you go to Japan or South Korea or Taiwan, you know, you pay inheritance tax. So you know, the post-communist legacy is still very much with us today, and it was instrumentalized by you know, property owners, you know, to develop a form of you know, zero redistribution. So that we're paying the price for that. And even in the West, you know, I think we have stopped thinking about what kind of economic system we want in the long run. So, you know, I'm trying to contribute to that a little bit, but look, it's only a book. It's only, you know, that's not what we need. Is new, you know, what worked in the 20th century to bring more equality was the development of new mass organization, trade unions, political parties, and you know, some new left political parties emerge, for instance, in South Europe, you know, after the 2008 financial crisis, after the Greek crisis, but they were basically crushed by the European Union government, you know, people in Brussels, Berlin, Paris, Christian Democrats in Germany, but also socialist center-left in France, you know, decided that it was better to crush Syriza so as to avoid Podemos replacing the Socialist Party in Spain. At the end of the day, you know, 10 years later, they wanted to get rid of the radical left, and they have the radical right in power in Italy and Poland. So, yeah, I think it was a wrong choice, but, you know, that's a complicated process to build new organization. But, you know, it will start again, and, you know, it will take time.
Thank you very much for this opportunity and to talk with you, and thank you very much for your very inspiring talk. So my question is about your concept of co-development. You mentioned in your book that the all successful examples of economic development were based on protectionist policies. So basically, when today's developed countries were developing their infant industries, they protected them until they were ready to compete with the developed countries of the time. So these are exactly the policies that are not available for today's developing countries. Because of the regimes, free trade regimes, and the financial regimes that you talk about in your book. So when you propose the co-development between the developed and less developed country, and you mention that it is possible to imagine co-development between European and African country, so are some conditions, preconditions necessary to be satisfied, and what this co-development would actually look like in practice? So thank you very much.
I think the first precondition is really to get away and to escape from this free trade ideology with no string attached. You know, we have to, you know, to accept the idea that, you know, there are conditions for economic relations between countries. There are social conditions of production, environmental conditions of production that need to be taken into account, and this has to be assessed country by country in a democratic manner. You know, this cannot be set in advance for all countries in the world with the presumption that you know, no protection of any kind is necessary. So we have to get away of this ideology. Let me make clear that in fact many countries have never followed this ideology. You know, China or, you know, the US, you know, do most of the time, you know, they do what they want. What they want to protect a sector, they protect a sector when they don't. So so you know, I think it was here the European Union, you know, played a quite negative role, because, you know, I think it was, but it's partly, you know, the legacy of the drama of the 20th century. You know, after World War I, World War II, there was this fear of government, you know, this fear of excessive government power, which was, you know, one of the bases for building sort of ordo liberal rules for free trade without government interference on the spirit of the, and you know, you can understand how it was built at the time. It's just that it's completely you know, misadjusted with the current reality. But again, I think environmental challenges in particular are going to push for a different regime, and we're already seeing that in the very recent years, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you for an excellent lecture. As I understand, democracy helps lower inequality. But what is the problem with ex-communist countries, including Serbia? We got proportional election system. In Britain, in France, you got 500 electoral units and people vote for MP. In Serbia, we vote only between 10 chief of party. There is no democracy. We are without voting right. And even Orwell mentioned that this happened because of that happened fascism in Germany. And we are witness that in every of this country, ultra-right rising. First with 3%, enter parliament 10, etc. What do you think about electoral system, how he can influence these things? And last question, how to explain that left, no mentioning economic inequality, they're only talking about inequality between women and men, LGBT, race, no mentioning about economic inequality.
Yeah, well, no, you know, I think yeah, but what I have tried to show you is that I think it's possible to talk about economic inequality, as you said, but also talk about gender inequality and racial inequality, because they are also very powerful forms of economic inequality. And so they, you know, we need to add
all these dimensions rather than to, you know, subtract them. For, regarding electoral system, okay, it's a very important and interesting discussion, but I don't think we're going to start a debate and lecture about electoral system here. Let me simply say that whether you have proportional representation or majoritarian electoral system for legislative election, in any case, you know, should not be viewed as a sort of end question about electoral democracy. I think we need to invent, you know, new form of participatory democracy, new form of participatory referendum, and Julia Cage has written a lot about this, about using, you know, assembly taken at random in order not to decide everything, but to start the discussion about a referendum which then can be held publicly with everybody participating. There are lots of new forms of democratic participation that are yet to be invented and developed rather than just you know, legislative election and presidential election.
Hajde, imali smo još jedno pitanje. I ovo je stvarno poslednje.
I'll be very short. I would like to ask you about the connection between inequality and technology. Because as we know, new technologies bring increase in earning and growth, but not necessarily in equality and distribution. How do we cope with it?
Maybe we should take a few last question and I answer every. No, what do you think?
Thank you. Professor, thank you for coming tonight, and I would like to have this opportunity. There is a great opportunity for us here to talk about one particular chapter in your book, which is called the so-called international help, in which you expressly talk about exploitation and extraction of the profit from the South, actually from the third world countries, but as well as the exploitation and extraction of the profit within European Union. So it will be very good, it is really relevant for us to talk about how this is happening within the Europe.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you again, and a very short question. So you were saying a lot about the policy changing and everything, so the question is, which you haven't covered, is, but how is possible to like do, I mean, practically, like, are you part of any communist party, or should we, after your lecture, all of us become a member of communist party? I mean, what is the practical way to implement it, because it's like the main question, because like abstract, it's, we need to have new social movement, obvious, but what we have now is parties and electoral system and so on. And yeah, basically it's it.
Okay, so help me pass it over here and over here.
No.
Okay. Okay, too late.
Sorry.
Go ahead, and these three questions and wrap it up.
Okay, so three questions. So the three questions are very interesting. You know, I would love to be able to answer them completely, but technology, the key issue, you know, is really the democratic oversight of technological change and the rights that are given to the different stakeholders. So take the example of automated intelligence and, you know, artificial intelligence, ChatGPT, for instance, which was developed in the past few years. This is, you know, this is a typical example where what we describe as a technological innovation is a lot based on, you know, private appropriation of other people's production, and in particular intellectual production. So, you know, what's completely crazy with the example of ChatGPT is that you use, you know, all the writings of other people, you know, including all the books of other people, journal articles of other people. You have this algorithm sort of doing a synthesis of all this information, and then you give this synthesis and you don't describe at all, you know, who are the people who have made this contribution that you used, which has, you know, incredible implication, because then you don't even know, you know, what are the sources that you use, so you don't know what to trust, what not to trust, and of course you steal the intellectual property rights of other people. So here is a typical example where the problem is not the technological innovation in itself, but the way it is governed. And in this case, it seems completely obvious to me that government should say, look, you can do all the ChatGPT you want, but you have to make public your computer code, and so that we can see exactly, you know, how your algorithm was trained and what are the sources that you used from other people's production, and then we can talk about copyright, and then we can talk about reliability, and we can have a democratic conversation about how to regulate that. But what's completely crazy is to say, okay, you know, you don't need to tell us anything, and you. So anyway, that's you know, that will be, I think, a very important issue about the regulation of technological change in the future, and this can make technological change more or less, you know, appropriable by a few individuals or beneficial to broader groups of the population. Two questions on international help, international aid, and then the last one on what can we do. Yeah, international aid, as I explained in the book, there's a huge hypocrisy by the Western countries, and in particular the richest Western countries, when they pretend that, you know, they are very generous with poor countries with international aid, or when they pretend that they are very generous with Eastern Europe countries by paying for structural regional funds and send a lot of money to Poland or Hungary. Because when Western countries say that, they typically forget to take into account the income flow going on the other side, and in particular the profit flows, you know, getting out of Africa or getting out of Poland and Hungary, and which in practice are typically much bigger than the international aid going from the West to the other countries. So, you know, in the case of Poland or Hungary, you know, it's very striking to see that over the past 10 to 15 years, okay, these countries received maybe, you know, the equivalent of 2-4% of their GDP in regional funds, but the outflow of profits going to German shareholders or French shareholders, or it could be US shareholders, but it's typically coming from Western Europe investors, has been, you know, 6-8% of GDP, so much bigger than the public aid. Now, this is not saying that, you know, European integration was bad. You know, it was a win-win game potentially, but the winners are the biggest winners are typically the Western investors who have made a huge profit. And, you know, it means that, you know, you need to discuss about the level of wages in Poland and Hungary. And more generally, you know, you cannot, you know, the winners of the economic system always want to naturalize market forces, and they always want to pretend that the primary distribution of income is fair. You know, wages are fair, profits are fair, you know, they come from the sky and from the and then we should only look at redistribution after the primary distribution, and we should look at the generous you know, the generosity of the winner of the market who redistribute a small fraction of what they are made. But in fact, these market forces you know, depend on specific institution, bargaining power of workers, labor unions, social harmonization, fiscal harmonization, or the lack of such harmonization. So yes, this has to change. Last question: what should we do? Should we all join a communist party? You know, I have no problem with the word communism, but I tend to prefer socialism, because I think it's a a little bit less damaged by history, and so I prefer to talk about democratic socialism, participatory socialism. But you know, I'm not here to do the police of language. You know, if the word communism manages to find its way in the future, I have no problem with this. What the issue is really the content. So what we need is to have new political organization and political movement which really dare talking about what kind of long-run economic system we want. Where do we want to go? And you know, for a long time, you know, communist parties, you know, were describing, and to some extent, socialist parties were describing a future based on, you know, complete nationalization of the means of production. Now, the problem is that this long-run view was maybe not the best possible long-run view, and with the failure of this movement, it was not replaced by anything else, and many people, you know, have sort of stopped thinking about what kind of long-run economic system we want. So, you know, what I'm trying to do here is a very little and small contribution to this thinking, which has to be, has to be much more comprehensive, much more collective, much more ambitious. But at the end of the day, this is what we will need. We need political organization who dare to say, this is where I want to go. This will take time. These are the steps. But ultimately, you know, this is where we want to go. And I think, you know, I think there's lots of citizens from all over the world in all countries which in fact are, you know, waiting for this kind of demand. And just to conclude, you know, one of the results we get in our book with Julia on the history of elections in France is that, you know, we've had a huge fall in electoral participation in a country like France in recent decades. For the first time, you know, we have the rich municipalities who are voting, you know, 1.5 times more than the poor municipalities. It was not always like this, you know, in the 60s, 70s, 80s, partly because of the union of the left and the Communist Party, the Socialist Party, you had 80% participation, you had actually higher participation in poorer municipalities than in richer municipalities, because there was some hope of something. Now, there was some disappointment, but, you know, that doesn't mean, you know, some new hope, some new perspective has to be constructed. It will take time, but I think, you know, this will happen in the end.
Thank you, Thomas. Thank you so, so much. I have to say this was a cool last question, but it's not the last question, as you can continue tomorrow. Tomorrow at 11 o'clock, Julia Cagé at the Faculty of Economics and Business of the University of Belgrade. They will both be present, so Julia and Thomas will continue to work throughout the weekend. So we have to at least make sure they get a dinner tonight. I'll see you tomorrow at 11 to continue this discussion. Thank you so much.